Hello, everyone, and might I add, Merry Christmas. For my 100th video, I'd like to return to what I know and love. The Simpsons is a show that almost everyone around the world has at least heard of. Growing from its humble beginnings as the series of animated shorts on the Tracey Ullman show to a colossal conglomerate of television that has done everything from personal character stories, entertaining thrill rides, wacky hypnotisms, after-school specials, uncomfortable, unfunny, pathetic attempts to stay relevant, and wacky hypnotisms. You could say, The Simpsons is the most successful television show of all time. But how did this happen, I hear you ask? Well, today I present the first of a 700-part series charting the entirety of this little show from its humble beginnings, early signs of promise, heyday, and eventual downfall. So today, we're taking a look at the first ever episode of The Simpsons. Simpsons roasting on an open fire. Throughout the video, I'll be explaining how the show began by setting up its titular main cast, as well as countless vibrant side characters in just this first episode. We'll laugh, we'll cry, perhaps we'll learn something. This is How The Simpsons Became The Greatest Show Of All Time, Part 1. I'm open to suggestions for shorter, more concise titles.
Chestnuts roasting on an open fire. Jack Frost nipping at your nose.
So, to begin with, I can't really think of a particular analytical way of saying this, and if I did, I can't help but think it would make me come off as some sort of self-aggrandizing know-it-all, so I'm just gonna say it. Hearing the debut of The Simpsons theme in just a 5-second intro fills me with so much joy. It's a very interesting choice to begin with a Christmas special. In a way, it's kind of like their equivalent of The Simpsons movie now, considering how the show began as just a series of minute-long shorts, now becoming a whole 20-minute-long episode. This episode is written by American cartoonist Mimi Pond, and is actually the only episode she wrote, so for setting up a huge cast with a somewhat heartfelt story that ties it all together, she definitely deserves a lot of credit. The first line of dialogue spoken in this episode is by Marge, warning Homer to be more careful with his driving, and Homer replying, "There's no time to be careful." Do you realize how genius that is? Yes, nowadays the idea of a dysfunctional family with a crude, dumb father has kind of run its course, but back when this show aired, this was a completely new, fresh idea, and with his first line of dialogue, Homer J. Simpson gets this point across immediately. Then, 2 seconds later, they arrive, which is kind of odd, but I'm not gonna dwell on minor nitpicks like that. What I am going to address is that Marge was just warning Homer for being reckless with safety, and then she just leaves the car door open? Like, are you trying to get your car stolen? It also appears to be the only car parked, which is odd given how many people are present at the recital, but maybe everyone else just parked somewhere else. Homer then greets a man I've never heard or seen of ever again after this moment.
Hey Norman, how's it going? So you got dragged down here too, huh?
Goodbye forever, Norman. Then the best character appears. This is followed by some education BS. Like, come on, I didn't turn on this cartoon to start learning about other people's cultures. Get the hell out of here. And hey, look, it's uncanny Ralph Wiggum.
He's still funny, but not ha-ha funny.
Then, we get this.
I need help reacting to something.
The first appearance of Lisa Simpson, everybody. Now listen, Matt. I know when it comes to the depiction of your female characters, you're certainly no Dan. But I feel as though I speak for everyone when I say we probably could have done without all of this.
The fourth grade will now favor us with a melody Medley.
I don't know if this was an outtake, but it really keeps me up at night. Bart's first appearance in the show, just like his parents, quickly demonstrates the kind of character he is. A bad boy. And it also begins the multiple decade-long rivalry between him and Principal Skinner, so that's kinda cool. A moment of silence for this woman's nose. Now we get the first look at the iconic Simpsons house, with the sofa on the right side of the room for some reason. We get our first piece of Simpsons lore about the death of Snowball, which I can't wait to be turned into an entire prequel show about how the Simpson family became too powerful to stabilize itself, resulting in some kind of civil war. Then we learn that Abe Simpson is a person. Cue every single flashback to his past that the later series has become obsessed with doing.
Maggie is walking by herself? Lisa got straight A's, and Bart, well, we love Bart.
Then we get some of Homer's trademark rage, and then his immortal catchphrase. Out of all of the members of the Simpsons family, I would probably say that Lisa has changed the most, as much as one can change in a status quo show, so seeing these early signs of an actual childlike personality is quite jarring, but also welcome. This definitely could have been a better introduction to her character, by the way.
A tattoo?
A what?
Yeah, they're cool and they last the rest of your life.
You will not be getting a tattoo for Christmas.
Yeah, if you want one, you'll have to pay for it out of your own allowance.
Good joke. And now the introduction of Marge's twin sisters.
Yellow.
Marge, please.
Who's this?
May I please speak to Marge?
This is her sister, isn't it?
Is Marge there?
Who shall I say is calling?
This first interaction also perfectly paints their hateful relationship. Homer's the aggressor towards them, and they just retort with flat, thinly veiled mutual hatred. Comedy gold. Homer almost dies, which the children applaud for some reason, and we get our first and admittedly rare appearance of Chad Flanders. Late series try to make him a good person or whatever, but in this first instance he's just a complete alpha and it's not even clear if he's doing it intentionally. I'd wager he probably wasn't, given his character going forward, but it's just fun to watch. What the f*** is this angle? Anyway, the plot finally begins now that they've introduced the family, as well as a few side characters. Bart decides he wants to get a tattoo, figuring that when they're stranded in a desert somewhere, Marge will be super impressed by it and not have to worry about water, building a campfire, dehydration, you know, the basic desert survival stuff. Then we see Homer checking off stuff attentively on a clipboard, almost like it's his job. It's probably an animation error or something. Then we hear the voices of Burns and Smithers. While Smithers' voice sounds roughly like it does now, Mr. Burns' voice kind of sounds off.
Hello?
Burns says that there'll be no Christmas bonus this year, demonstrating Mr. Burns' consistent characterization as a bastard man. Then Bart ruins Christmas by getting a tattoo. No one likes moths that much. We meet this doctor who isn't Dr. Hibbert for some reason, and he says something about pricey medical procedures or something. I wasn't listening. I was too busy eating tea and crumpets and listening to God Save the King.
Hi, Caramba!
Now whatever you do, boy, don't squirm. You don't want to get this sucker near your eye or your groin.
Homer comes home to realize that their Christmas money is spent and they now come from a broken home. I really like this animation, by the way. I know it's the first series and it isn't really well known for its animation that looks nice at all, but I'd rather have this than some off-yellow blandness. Then Homer leaves the house via the kitchen? And he doesn't succumb to hypothermia. It's kind of funny that this same sound effect is used for the Japanese Santa bot in Series 8, with John Waters explicitly saying how abysmal it sounds. Though Homer decides to withhold the information of him not having the Christmas bonus this year, it's done in a sincere way, with Homer hoping that he'll come to a solution and doesn't want to worry his family. Yes, it's kind of a dumb decision which mostly just serves the plot, but it's also very fitting with the incompetent but loving father role we've seen so far, which will continue for a few more series. Then, whilst Christmas shopping for his family, he completely forgets about Lisa, unless he was planning on having her share the paper with Bart. Whatever. Another encounter with Chad Flanders, and another opportunity for Homer to once again fail the dick measuring contest. Except, in this scenario, the dicks equate to how much love you have for your wife and kids. You know what, forget I said anything. Also, I think Todd Flanders's voice change is perhaps the most jarring out of all the characters. It's like he went through reverse puberty or something. Then, we have an uncharacteristically good Mo, who isn't trying to commit suicide at Christmas, hilarious as that may be. And Barney honestly sounds the most like his later counterpart. If it wasn't for the weird blonde hair, this would probably be an exact replica of his character throughout the show.
Do you like children?
What do you mean? All the time? Even when they're nuts?
I feel as though this joke would have had a very different outcome several series later, but as is, pretty good. This entire Santa school segment is pretty funny. No idea why the teacher has a thick Austrian accent, but it's random stuff like that that elevate the absurdism, much like the show would later be known for. Which is all really good. Homer walks in on Patty and Selma groping his kids, and we get the first interaction of one of Homer's many rivalries throughout the series. Homer decapitates and traffics a tree away from its natural habitat. No idea where Homer got the chainsaw or how he was able to evade two guard dogs whilst dragging a tree. No one is the wiser, it seems.
Get a load of that quote-unquote Santa.
Can't believe those kids are falling for it.
Hey, Milhouse.
Milhouse? Milhouse? What kind of name is Milhouse? I am never going to get over how ridiculous that name is. So Bart is hanging out with Milhouse and Lewis, and they're instantly skeptical about this man before them and how he isn't the real Santa. In fact, Bart is so adamant about this that he intends to de-beard him. It's weird how he knows that it isn't the real Santa, but is utterly shocked to find out that it's his father. It's also weird that no one objects to this man dressed as Santa carrying a boy into his workshop, but anyway. Homer reveals they don't have any money. Given that this is technically all Bart's fault, Homer should be strangling him right now. Not advocating for child abuse or anything, but it just seems odd that this physical altercation doesn't transpire. The fact that all of this work resulted in $13 was honestly very depressing. But hey, gambling. Gambling's fun, right? That old happy little elf is perhaps the most grotesque thing I've ever seen. Also, Grandpa has his first line, but I couldn't tell what he was saying. Santa's little helper is mentioned for the first time, and I do think it's very clever how they introduce this as what would traditionally be the setup for a happy, feel-good ending, only for it to fail spectacularly. It's also a tad concerning that Homer must rely on the counsel of his 10-year-old son in order to make the decision to throw away all of his family's Christmas money, but not the stupidest thing he's ever done, so... Barney does receive vast wealth by the outcome of this race, which I guess goes to show that if you're an incompetent father, gambling will make you lose everything, but if you're a blind drunk, it'll make your life substantially better in every way. Good to know. Then we get the first of a rare series of POV shots throughout the show.
Can we keep him, Dad, please?
But he's a loser! He's pathetic! He's... a Simpson.
This line is pretty great. As I previously mentioned, this concept for a show about a dysfunctional family was not really a thing before this show happened, and lines like this fully cement that internal concept.
I didn't get my Christmas bonus. I tried not to let it ruin Christmas for everybody, but no matter what I did...
Hey everybody, look what we got!
Even though there are very few episodes following this in which Santa's little helper is the main focus, I like that they kept up the running gag that the whole family unconditionally loves the dog, kind of more than they love Homer. Heartwarming stuff. Also, who the hell took that photo? I know it's a minor nitpick, but this shit keeps me up at night. So, yeah, that was the first episode. There's definitely work to be done, as I would say, whilst there are a few jokes which I appreciated, I wouldn't say I laughed out loud for any of them, but there's definitely a lot of potential here as well. Homer's characterization here is particularly good, especially with the various interactions he has with the other characters. The animation is good enough for the main characters, although the background work is kind of whack.
You see, I was a very good-looking young man. Much more good-looking than those two.
All in all, a very promising start to a show, and I hope you found this to be a promising start to my series. I understand a task like this will most certainly take years to complete, even longer considering I won't be uploading an episode every week, so I really appreciate any support, whether it be giving a like or even just commenting how this was definitely not my worst video. Anyway, probably look out for part 2 in 2 weeks, I don't know.